Integration, what could be more fun? Well, maybe not for everyone, but in any case, I haven't posted anything mathematical for quite some time, so I'm going to make an attempt. So this video is about computing complicated integrals, and this video kind of assumes that you, as a person watching this, went to school and you know trivial things like integration by parts, for example. And I'm gonna focus mainly on the kind of basic integration, kind of Riemann integrable stuff. None of that Lebesgue, Stiltius, Itô, Skovorod, and the rest of it. So I'm gonna just show a couple of recipes or patterns which you can use and sort of apply when you're integrating things. And we're gonna begin with a well-known approach, which is the approach of polar coordinates and the use of polar coordinates in calculating integrals, including integrals which have nothing to do with polar coordinates as such. So for those of you who don't remember polar coordinates, essentially the idea is that if you, okay, I'm gonna try and set things right here. So if you have an XY coordinate system, then each point it has its own X and Y coordinates. But in addition to that, so you might say that, this is the coordinate X, this is coordinate Y, and here's my point, but you can also measure it differently. You can measure it as the angle from the X-axis, this angle theta, and the distance, which is this distance, which is r. So the relationship between x, y, and r theta is fairly obvious. So we have x obviously being equal to r cos theta, and similarly y being equal to r sine theta. And then, of course, due to Pythagoras, the distance r, or specifically r squared, is equal to x squared plus y squared. So these are the definitions that we're going to be using if we want to do anything with relation to polar coordinates. So the idea is that instead of using x and y, you start using r and theta instead, and the rules for converting between one and another are described up above. Okay, so how can this help us? Well, one of the well-known integrals is the Gaussian integral, which is the integral of e to the minus x squared. Now, the interesting thing about this integral is it doesn't have a closed-form solution, so you cannot provide this as a function of anything. And as a result, what happens in the real world when we use this in financial math, for example, we have numerical methods. So we have this very old book by Abramowitz and Stegun, which outlines some of the numerics with regard to how to calculate this for particular values. And also, there are lots of variations on how to calculate this because you can get really good precision, or you can get sort of average precision, depending on the number of coefficients you use in the numerical methods. But we're not going to talk about the numerical stuff. We're going to talk about how would you calculate this integral, but with certain limits. Like, for example, if you wanted to calculate it on all the real numbers, so from minus infinity to infinity, and this is actually possible. And the answer, I'm going to sort of jump ahead, the answer is the square root of pi. And to get this answer, we're going to use polar coordinates, surprisingly enough. Because what we're going to do, you can see that there's a bit of a hint here in terms of what we have, in that you have the x here. So instead of the x, you could easily have a y. So we can redefine this to be the integral of minus infinity to infinity of e to the minus y squared. And let's not forget the dx here and dy here. So these are identical. So we can give this the letter I. We can define this integral as I, and then we can compute I squared to be the product of this part and this part. So how do we do this? Well, actually rather easy. So it's going to be the integral minus infinity to infinity e to the minus x squared dx times the integral of minus infinity to infinity of e to the minus y squared dy. Now, thanks to Fubini, we can mix and match these integrals. So we can sort of lump the integrals together, and we can just put them side by side. So we'll have the two integrals from minus infinity, both of them to infinity. And here we have e to the minus x squared minus y squared dx dy. Hopefully by now you can see why we have this polar coordinates thing, because we can jump from the xy coordinates to the polar coordinates using the rules that we've already defined up above. So what we'll get in this case is we'll get the following. So x squared plus y squared is r squared, and if you fiddle the other terms, so we want to get rid of dx dy, and we want obviously dr d theta somewhere, you'll get something like the following. So you'll get an integral from 0 to 2 pi times the integral from 0 to infinity, once again pi, because theta goes from 0 to 2 pi, and infinity because r has to go from 0 to infinity to cover, you know, every point on r squared. So that's what we do, and here we basically have something like e to the minus r squared times r dr d theta. And of course, there are no terms. All the terms that included theta would have been cancelled out. So the integral from 0 to 2 pi d theta is simply 2 pi. So we have that. Let me move it up here. So we have 2 pi multiplied by the integral from 0 to infinity e to the minus r squared r dr. And that, of course, is easy to compute because you take the 2, stick it back in there, and then dr times 2 is simply dr squared. So you have pi times the integral from 0 to infinity e to the minus r squared dr squared. So this is equal to 1. So the whole thing is equal to pi, and so we have this equality that I squared is equal to pi. So the integral squared is equal to pi, which is the integral itself. As soon as this tablet stops crashing, the integral itself is equal to the square root of pi, and that's the result of our Gaussian integral. So that's one example where, you know, we didn't even need polar coordinates to begin with, but we went with this geometric interpretation and then we got something. Let's take a look at another geometric interpretation, which is also reasonably interesting. So essentially, let's suppose you want to compute the integral from 0 to infinity of dx over 1 plus x squared, for example. So what can we do with this? I'm pretty sure that most of you know this integral already. That's you know, the integral in closed form is the arctangent tan to the minus 1 of x. So you can just stick in the values and get your result. But we're gonna calculate this integral without actually using this fact. So we're going to sort of disregard the fact that this is equal to the inverse tangent, and we're going to instead consider a geometric interpretation. And here is the interpretation that we can go for. So let's imagine the coordinate axes, and let's imagine that you have a circle. So you have a circle going like this. Not a perfect circle. It has to be, you know, centered at the origin and whatever. So now if you imagine that you have a radius r, and you're trying to calculate the arc. So you're trying to calculate, let's say, this bit. Now this bit, let's call it L. L is equal to r theta. But if we make a unit circle, if we make these coordinates all 1 and negative 1 respectively, that should be a negative 1, by the way. So if we make it 1, then the length is actually equal to just theta because the radius is 1. So on the other hand, what we can do is we can actually represent this value, we can represent theta as an integral. So we can say, oh, by the way, this is an integral from 0 to theta of some variable dt. T is absolutely meaningless in this case. It's not being used for anything. It's just there so that we, an arbitrary variable of integration. But the thing about this setup is we can now start messing with this integral. So this integral looks really interesting. So L is equal to the integral from 0 to theta of 1 dt. I'm going to explicitly specify 1 here. So then what we can do is we can say, well, if it's 0 to theta, we're going to rewrite 1 as something else. And I'm looking back at, you know, the kind of integral that we have, we can start messing with it. We can say, well, this is going to be 1 over cos squared t divided by 1 over cos squared t dt, because it's still 1. Okay, and then we take the cos squared, and 1 over cos squared, we represent 1 as sine squared plus cos squared. So you can effectively rewrite this as an integral of 1 over cos squared t divided by 1 plus tan squared t. Where still, you know, there's nothing magical happening here. We just made a few rearrangements, and the integral, this part is still equal to 1, so that's okay. Now we make a substitution. Now we say, you know, we will say as soon as I get back to where we actually were. So we make a substitution. We say that theta no time for that yet. So we say that x is equal to the tangent of t. X is equal to the tangent of t. What this means is that dx is equal to dt over cos squared t. cosquared t, like so. Okay, so we're actually getting a different integral. So the zero here, and there is theta here. But now what we're going to do is we're going to tangify, so to speak, the limits, because we're making the substitution. So we have a new value of L. We have L equals the integral from 0 to tangent of theta dx over 1 plus x squared. Okay, so we made the substitution, which is really convenient for us. Now, the interesting thing is that we magically got our results, surprisingly enough, because look at what we're actually trying to find. If we kind of remind ourselves of what we were looking for in the first place. In the first place, we were looking for the integral from 0 to infinity of dx over 1 plus x squared. That's exactly what we have here, except the limit, the theta here. So how do we get infinity? Well, what is the what phi gives you its tangent as infinity? Obviously, that's pi over 2. So we now have effectively an answer straight away, because on the one hand, we know that this integral is equal to all of this complicated stuff. On the other hand, by definition, we know that this integral is actually equal to phi, is equal to phi, like so. So if I plug in pi over 2 here and pi over 2 here, I get the integral from 0 to infinity dx over 1 plus x squared is equal to pi over 2. So I automatically got my result without knowing the implicit solution for the integral of dx over 1 plus x squared. I simply plug in phi equals pi over 2 here and here, and I have my result. And similarly, you can sort of start getting all sorts of other results. For example, if you want the integral from 0 to 1 of dx over 1 plus x squared, well, that's easy, because you think about what angle has a tangent equal to 1, and that's pi over 4. So that's your result. Or, for example, if you have the integral from 0 to the square root of 3 of dx over 1 plus x squared, well, that's obviously pi over 3, because that's what gives you the tangent of square root of 3. So that's another very interesting approach to the geometric interpretation. So just as a reminder, we looked at the kind of geometric equivalence of the length of the arc, and then did you know, it's quite often that you get this kind of thing where you have an integral of 1, but then you stop playing with the 1 and you start representing it in all sorts of crazy ways, and you find some sort of interesting result. Let's take a look at something else. Let's take a look at how to break apart the range of integration. And the range of integration, I keep messing about with the tablet here, because, well, I'm using ancient software and the tablet isn't perfect either. So let's suppose, for instance, that you're trying to do an integral from 0 to infinity of log x divided by 1 plus x squared dx. Now, what we can do is, this is an integral from 0 to infinity. We can break it apart. So we can say that the integral from 0 to infinity is the integral from 0 to 1 plus the integral from 1 to infinity, which is perfectly legal. So what we're going to do is we're going to try and calculate this part specifically. And the other part should follow. So we're going to calculate the integral from 0 to 1. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to make a substitution here. I'm going to make a substitution t equals 1 over x. Or you can specify the other way around. You can say x is equal to 1 over t. Both of these are correct. So as a result, you're going to have dx equals minus dt over t squared. So we can rewrite the integral. We're doing from 0 to 1 of log x over 1 plus x squared. So the integral from 0 to 1 of log x over 1 plus x squared is equal to, and here comes the fun stuff. So we've changed the, we're changing from x to t, so we're changing the limits. So we plug in the values of 0 and 1, and we get 1 over 0 and 1 over 1. So the limits are now from infinity to 1. And then we plug in the actual substitution. So instead of log x, we have log of 1 over t, because you see x is equal to 1 over t here, divided by 1 plus 1 over t squared. And then the dt term, which has minus 1 over t squared dt. So that's minus 1 over t squared dt. Okay, so this is actually very easy to get rid of. So first of all, we take the minus, so we'll take out the minus. And we'll also multiply t squared by the bottom here, so we'll have the integral. I'm not going to write the limits anymore. Well, actually, I should, because we're going to be warping them once again. So from infinity to 1, we get log of 1 over t divided by t squared plus 1, because we multiply t squared by this and t squared by this, and we get t squared plus 1 dt. So then what we can do is we can once again take the minus and drag it sort of back into the integral, and once again we're going to kind of flip the terms over, so to speak, because if you kind of drag in the minus, you swap the order. So we can say that we're now going from 1 to infinity instead, and the minus is going to go into the log of 1 over t, and actually you flip the whole thing. So essentially we're going to flip log 1 over t, and to the minus 1, that becomes log t divided by t squared plus 1 dt, but then the minus is going out again. So this is the kind of final result that we have. And it turns out that what you're having here is identical to what you have here. And that's kind of crucial. So this part is actually equal to this part with a minus sign. So it's kind of negative 1. So kind of if this is alpha and this is beta, then you can see that alpha is equal to minus beta. So somebody's asking you to calculate the integral from 0 to 1 plus the integral from 1 to infinity, but this is alpha plus beta, but beta is equal to minus alpha, or alpha is equal to minus beta, so the sum is equal to 0, because the left part and the right part are actually equivalent. Okay, let's take a look at something else, how to kind of frag the integral into the odd and even parts. So this is the kind of general idea that you can take any kind of function and separate it into odd and even parts, which might seem weird to some of you, but it's reasonable. So let's suppose, for example, that we're doing an integral from minus 1 to 1 of cos x over e to the 1 over x plus 1. Yeah, so we want this integral, and we're going to make a couple of substitutions, or definitions, or other. We're going to define some of these parts. So we're going to say that this part is equal to f of x. So in other words, f of x is defined as e to the 1 over x, and then we'll do the g of x being the rest of it. So g of x is going to be the entire thing. G of x is going to be cos of x divided by f of x. Plus 1. So now, obviously we want the integral of g of x. We want the integral from minus 1 to 1. How do we get it? Well, the approach that we can take is we can actually split up g of x into its even and odd parts. And this is the key to this entire approach. So we'll have some function g even of x plus g odd of x. Now you might be wondering, well, how is this legal? What does this all mean? Let me explain to you what's actually going on. So let's suppose that instead of x, you take negative x and you start feeding it into g. So you're trying to take g of negative x. Now g of negative x, if we agree that it can be expressed in terms of the sum of an even odd function, then it's going to be the g even of negative x plus g odd of negative x. Now we know about even functions is that it's the same as feeding g of x. So this is going to be g even of just ordinary x, g of x plus, and the odd function is going to actually give us the negative. So it's going to give us a minus g odd of x. Okay, so why did we just do this, and what exactly is the point of this? Well, we now have an expression for g of x and g of minus x. And if you add them up, if you add this part and this part together, notice if you add them up, these two go, but this one is doubled, so you get two times the even part. So what you can say, effectively, is you can say that the even part of x is g of x plus g of minus x, divided by 2. And similarly, you can do it for the odd part as well. So for the odd part, you can say that, oh Christ, this is frustrating. It's not how this thing should be working. But anyway, g odd of x is equal to g of x minus g of minus x divided by 2. So essentially what we've just done is we made definitions of even and odd parts of the function on the basis of the function taking x as well as negative x. That's all that we're doing here. But why did we do all of this? Well, we did it so that we can rewrite the integral, because remember, we're interested in the integral from minus 1 to 1 of g of x, dx. But we know that we can rewrite g in terms of the even and odd parts. So the integral from minus 1 is equal to the integral of the even part plus the integral of the odd part, dx. But by definition of the oddness of the function, this entire thing, so the entire thing with the odd function going from negative 1 to 1, this entire thing disappears. So we're left with just the even part. We're left with just this part. Okay, so what can we do with this? Well, let's actually now plug in this definition. So we are left with only the even part. How about we plug in this definition back under the integral? So let's do that. So we're going to have this integral being the integral from negative 1 to 1 of the actual function. Now, instead of just writing out g of x, g of minus x, we're going to remind ourselves of what g actually is. And g happens to be cos of x divided by f of x plus 1. So I'm going to write it here on the side. So g of x equals cos of x divided by f of x. Is it minus 1? Plus 1. Plus 1. Oops, that's an extraneous line. How do I get rid of it? Nothing works. The keys don't work here. Plus 1. Right. So, essentially, we have this formula, g of x minus g of minus x. And we want to plug in the over 2 as well. And we want to plug in this part into this formula. So we take out 1/2. So 1/2 is essentially going to be here. And what do we have? We have g of x, which is cos x divided by f of x plus 1, minus g of minus x. That's cos of minus x divided by, once again, f of minus x plus 1. Now is a good time for us to remind ourselves of, first of all, cos is an even function. Cos is an even function. And as a result, you can take out the cos. So 1/2 integral, and then you're going to have cos x, or you can just stick cos x over 2 here, and then you have the following. So at the top, if you multiply out the fractions, so because we have to subtract, so we have to get the common denominator, which might actually get quite big. So the common denominator is going to be f of x plus 1 times f of minus x plus 1, which is equal to f of x, f of minus x, plus f of x, plus f of minus x plus 1. Quite a lot here. And then we multiply out these terms. Now remember, we took out the cos x, so there is a 1 here and a 1 here. So it's going to be f of minus x plus 1 minus f of x minus 1. Something like this. Actually, let me just verify that. Oh, wait. Cos of minus x is minus cos x. So sorry, that should be a plus here. So f of x plus 1, plus f of x, and plus 1 again. Okay, now the trick here is that the trick here is this bit, the f of x times f of minus x, because we know what f of x is. We know that f of x is equal to e to the 1 over x. So if we try f of x, f of minus x, what we're going to end up with is we're going to end up with e to the 1 over x multiplied by e to the minus 1 over x, which is all equal to 1. So this whole thing, I may as well just erase it, because this whole thing suddenly becomes a 1. Oh, this is taking too much time. Damn it. There we go. Okay, so this becomes a 1. And now if you look at the numerator and denominator, you'll see that they are identical. So this entire fraction is actually completely unnecessary. It's equal to 1, so we can just get rid of it. So at the end, what we end up with is we end up with this definition that g even of x is equal to cos x over 2. So then we just take the integral, and that's hopefully rather easy. So what we've done essentially is we've reduced the integral from minus 1 to 1 cos x over e to the 1 over x plus 1 dx. We've reduced it to the integral from negative 1 to 1 of cos x over 2 dx, which is equal to sine of 1, which is equal to 0.841, and so on and so forth. So these are some of the tricks in integration, and they're good to have in your head if you're doing a completely complicated integral, even though, strictly speaking, most of the computer algebra systems nowadays will do the integrals for you. But it's still good to know how to do it by hand if the need arises. So thanks for watching, and take care.